Basic Black After Dark, the all new podcast show with your host, Black Diamond.
Hello, hello, hello. Hey, everybody. I am so glad you are here tonight. We have a great show lined up for you. I am Black Diamond, your host of Basic Black After Dark, where I discuss sensitive topics. They arise based on the needs of the community and the expectations of the community. So whatever's going on in your community, I try to get all the information that I could. And from time to time, I'm going to have some guests dropping by with other topics, topics that they feel as though is important to them, which is important to me. But most of the time, we have relaxed conversations about family changes, parenting styles, and cultural customs. But tonight, it's going to be a little different. I'm celebrating National Foster Care Month for the entire month of May. And if you know me, you know that it's all about the kids, and I'm in love with doing anything for foster care. I invite you to celebrate this night with me. So I'm going to give you a little bit of history on foster care. For some people who don't quite know what foster care is about, who always wanted to know, who may have heard stories about foster care, a lot of rumors about foster care, I'm not saying that I'm here to set the record straight, but I'm just here to give you a little bit of information, so maybe that'll help you out. Now, foster care, it is considered out-of-home placement, and it is a system in which minor children, they've been placed into a ward. I don't even like really using that word ward, but that's sometimes the way that they term it. A group home or a private home that is state certified. Sometimes they go to a relative's home and they're considered foster parents, but they all have to be approved by the state that they're in. Now I want to give you a little backstory and my journey through foster care. I don't know how many times I've been asked if I've ever been in foster care. And I guess because people see that I'm so involved with foster care, that I do so much with foster care and for foster care children, foster care month, even for National Adoption Day. But no, I've never been in foster care. But I do have some experience with the foster care system. First, I want to let you know that I have been parenting 12 children. And I know I get it all the time. You have 12 kids? Yeah, I do. But three are my biological and nine are my nieces and nephews. So I've been doing this for a while. I guess I can say, well, I might be telling you my age, but over 40 years, I've been working with children and families. So they've come through kinship care, foster care, custody and guardianship, and adoption. Now, some people don't really know what custody and guardianship is, and they confuse it sometimes with kinship care. But guardianship is the legal process that allows a designated person to have the responsibility for the child that's placed in their home. They also have the authority to make decisions for that child. Now, the decisions is nothing that's out of the ordinary. Decisions is something like, you know, doctor's appointments, school field trips, playing, you know, with their friends, you know, dentist appointments, things like that. Those are the decisions that they have, but there are legal decisions that has to be made, but those decisions are made with the Department of Social Services, and it still includes their parents. Their parents, as long as they didn't lose their rights, which they call it TPR, terminated parental rights, then the parent still has responsibility so they can be reunified with that child. Now, kinship care is when the guardian is a relative. It could be the aunt, the uncle, and it could be an older sibling as long as they're over the age of 18 in most states, but some states say that they have to be 21 years of age to be the relative caretaker for them. But it could also be a close family friend. Say your child considers somebody as their godparent, and they've known this person for a while, so they consider them their godparent or maybe an uncle, that they've been knowing this child all their life. That person can be considered a kinship. Sometimes they call it fictive kin, but they can be considered kinship care. As a foster parent, I was able to adopt through the New York City foster care system. Although I was never a foster child, I did walk in the shoes of a foster child because I wanted to know what it was like. And this was a few years back. And what I did was something called the trash bag challenge. And I know it doesn't sound great at all, trash bag, but it doesn't. But what it is that these children are walking around with a trash bag with all their belongings in it. So if they're removed from a home, they go from home to home and they never know when they're going to be moved. So they just grab their things, they put it in the trash bag and they keep moving. Sometimes you'll see that these children run away from the home that they were in, meaning the foster home or the group home, and all they have is that trash bag. So they put their belongings in and they just go someplace else. Most of the agencies do have luggage is on runaway and they just want to leave as quick as they came. They're going to grab whatever they can, and it's usually a trash bag, and they keep going. Well, I did that trash bag challenge, and it was unbelievable. It was an eye-opener for me. I started off with just taking one of those office trash bags, and I took my pocketbook, and I dumped everything inside of that bag. And I walked around everywhere I had to go. I kid you not, any place I had to go, I had that trash bag. But being that it was the smaller trash bag, it wasn't that bad. But the following week, I got a bigger bag, and I dumped everything that I had. Now, when I say everything that I had, whatever I was wearing the first week that I did that trash bag challenge, I put it in that bag. I put my makeup in there. I put pajamas in there. I put personal items, deodorant, whatever I can carry in that bag. And each week, I would do the same thing. Everything was going in that bag until I wound up the fourth week with a construction bag. That's how big it was. And people at my office thought I was crazy. I was dragging that bag in and out of the office every day. The only thing that was different was that I had a car. And these foster children, they don't have a car to travel in, except when they're being picked up by their social worker. So they're in the car that way. So you can just imagine traveling around with that. Until one day, I remember going out into the field. And I said, oh my God, I have to go out into the field. And I have this trash bag, and I'm doing this trash bag challenge. I honestly did not want to take the bag with me, but I said, in order to actually understand what they're going through, I have to take the bag. So I took the bag, a big old bag. I took it with me. And yeah, I got some stares and some looks. And, you know, I don't know what people were thinking. I don't know whether they thought that I was trying to go to the laundry, whether I was homeless, or whether I was donating the things that was in the bag. They just had no clue, but I got all sorts of looks. But I went into a government office one day, and I had that bag with me. And I was with a coworker. So we went through, well, she went through the conveyor belt, and she presented her ID and she went through with her pocketbook. I started to go through the same way she did. I didn't think it would be a problem, although I did have a bigger bag. So I walked through and they told me that they had to stop me to check my bag. So I asked, why do you have to stop me to check my bag, but you didn't check her bag? And they said, well, everybody that comes through, we have to check their bag. She showed ID, but I had ID too. I don't know what they were thinking. I think they were looking more so at the bag than what they were doing while looking at my ID. So I didn't want to make a big thing out of it because I was still at work. But in my head, I was just thinking, wow, this is what these kids go through when they're going through places and people are acting certain ways. So as I proceeded through, I was saying some things, maybe not actually under my breath, but I was saying it loud enough for him to hear it. I'll say it that way. And I was wondering, why is it that she was going through her bag and I couldn't go through with mine? The only thing that I felt was different was she had a Gucci and I had a Glad. So she was able to go through, and I said, you know, I'm going to go through, not have a problem, take care of what I have to take care of while I was in this building. And when the day was over and we finished doing what we had to do, when I came out, I walked over to him. To tell you the truth, it was a security guard, an officer. We were in court. So, of course, I wasn't going to try to make a big thing out of it because I'm in court, and the last thing I needed to do was be arrested or get fired from my job for making a scene. So I walked over to the officer and I explained to him the bag and what I was doing was the trash bag challenge, and I showed him my ID again. He wound up having a conversation, I think, better understanding of what was going on. But for me, it was knowing that I was stopped, and I felt like he went through my personal things, but he didn't go through hers. He treated me different than he treated the next person. So I understand, well, at that moment, I understood how some of these children are feeling when they're out in the public and people are looking at them certain ways and they're picking and choosing who they would rather have them around or be around them. And just the fact that they didn't look like maybe the average child because they had a bigger bag, or they weren't dressed a certain way, or They just had a certain look about them, which is what I wanted to have, a certain look about me. Maybe they thought I was a homeless adult instead of a foster kid. Well, you know, I'm a grown woman, so of course they probably thought I was a homeless adult. But the problem was they had no clue as far as what I was doing, and they were still treating me in an inappropriate way. So I understand that these children are treated in a way that they should not be treated. Each child who enters foster care, their story is different, but every kid's journey starts with some traumatic separation from their primary caregiver. No matter how flawed it may be, they're separated from their parents, from their family, from the people they knew. And I know that in most instances, when a child enters foster care, it starts with somebody making a report because someone has suspected abuse or neglect. Now, there are times, and I get it, that people make false reports, but the majority of the time, they're not false reports. And when I say false reports, I mean someone who's mad at somebody else. To get back at them, they'll say, oh, her children are neglected, or she's beating her kids, or he's doing this, that, or the other with their children just because they're upset with this person. It has absolutely nothing to do with the way that they're parenting their children or the way that their children are. They're upset. Well, they do enter care. Some people make that call. And to hear that a child entered foster care can be quite disturbing. But to enter foster care because you were abused or neglected, I understand. And the system understands that too. So each call is screened. And it's very important for the social workers to ask questions, to find out what's going on, to make sure that the report is a valid report. But when you have over 442,000 children in the foster care system, something's wrong. There's too many children. One child is too many children to be in the foster care system. Foster care can have the psychological effects on these children. They are very angry. And sometimes you don't blame them because they're separated from the only person that they know. They're not looking at their parents as being abusive to them or neglectful to them. They're looking at, you took me away from the person that loves me. Although that person may have abused them, that's who they know, who they love and they've been with. And they feel as though that person is the one that's going to protect them, although they may have been through something. A lot of them go through some grief because some of them never return home because it has been that bad. Or the parent never gets it together, so they can't return home. Then there's those who feel as though that it was betrayal. Suppose the child went to school and they had some bruises on them. The teacher found out and made the report. That child feels as though that they said something because the teacher asked the question, what happened? Sometimes they'll say, oh, I fell down. I was riding my bike. I fell off my skateboard. But when the children say things like that, it's over and over again. Every couple of weeks, they're coming in with a new bruise. But if you notice the bruising on these children, it may not be on the knee. It may not be on the front surface. It's in areas where you fall off your skateboard, the back of your leg is not going to be scarred up like that. These bruises that you see on them, they're purplish, maybe reddish. You'll see it around the neck. What happened to cause that bruise around the neck? What did they pull the scarf too tight? No, they didn't pull the scarf too tight. Somebody else did it. You have to look at these children's bodies to determine whether it's abuse and neglect or whether it was actually an accident that this child actually fell off the skateboard. Maybe the child did trip over something. But every case that comes in, it has to be investigated because these kids are innocent. Now, I know, believe me, I'm a mother of 12. Some children will work that last nerve, but not to the point of abuse and neglect. So we have these things that we put into place. A lot of these children suffer from anxiety. You know, they're afraid. They're nervous. They don't know what's going to happen to these. They're having depression, and they're seeing psychiatrists and therapists. They wind up with low self-esteem. Some of them are less satisfied with their life, and some of them try to commit suicide. Some of them say they want to kill themselves because they want to go back to their parents. These effects can be caused by pre-care events, removal from the family home, and the foster care experience itself. It can be devastating to these kids. Just imagine waking up someplace and you don't know anybody in there. Imagine being in your bed tonight and somebody standing over top of you. You don't know who that person is, but you're in your own home. You have no idea who that person is. How do you think you're going to feel? Mm-hmm. Now, as an adult, you're going to want to defend yourself. You're going to want to reach for something, a weapon, to try to defend yourself. Well, these kids are in somebody else's home. A person, they have no idea who this person is. They have no idea who may come into their room. And it could be an innocent foster parent just coming and checking on them at night. Well, these kids are scared out of their minds. Foster parents have medical health issues. Achievements, not all of them, because I have met some that are doing some fantastic things for themselves. But some of them have more emotional and behavioral problems than others. Then others their own age. The length of time of a child in foster care can increase in the risk of negative outcomes such as instability, confusion. They don't know what's going on. How did I get here? What happened? I didn't say anything. Why did this person tell? They're fearful. There is a whole lot of trauma that goes along with being in foster care for some of these children. They're traumatized already by the abuse that they endure. Now they're traumatized again because they're placed someplace. They have no idea what's going to happen to them. There's a lot of times that crimes are committed with these kids. Drug use, because they figure that's the only thing that's going to make me feel good, make me feel better. And then you have some that don't want to be anyplace. They just rather be on the street if they can't be with their family. Or there's some that don't want to be with their family because of the abuse, but they don't want to be with the family that you placed them with either. So they wind up being homeless. Believe it or not, social workers try to promote a child's psychological well-being, and they try to locate a stable environment, make sure that they have an education, and make sure that they're safe. Now, I'm not saying this because I'm a social worker. I'm saying this because it's true. We've placed hundreds of children in homes, loving homes, and the goal is for them to be reunified. But a lot of these children, they want to go home. They don't want to be in somebody else's home. Now, here's where you come in. Your local Department of Social Services is looking for people just like you to become a foster parent, with the greatest need being the teenagers and our pregnant and parenting teens. Yeah, I know some people don't want to take in teens. They have their issues. They're set in their ways. But you think of it. You're over 40. You're set in your ways, too. You get off of work. You come home. You have whatever beverage you like. You kick off your shoes. You turn on the TV. You may take a shower. That's being set in your ways, too. You weren't always like that as, what, a 10-year-old, 11-year-old. As you started to develop and get older, you started seeing what you wanted to adjust to in life. So some of these kids, they're set in their way. But if you were to be a foster parent and can take them into your loving home, you may be able to help them, give them that head start while their parent is working on them. So see, if the agency can help support the parent, because when we work with the child, we work with the family as well. Because the goal is for the child to go back home, not to stay in foster care, because foster care is temporary. At least for most children, it is. Then there's those that are the pregnant and parenting teens. Yes, sometimes when the child is pregnant and she has a baby, the parent kicks her out. Or she runs away and she wants to stay with the boyfriend or whoever she wants to stay with. They wind up in foster care. Sometimes they have their children while they're in foster care. We need homes for those children too, because these children are now parents. And if they don't get that guidance that's needed, their children wind up in foster care. Do you remember that number that I gave you, 442,000? That 442,000 also includes those pregnant and parenting teens who have children who are in foster care. Now, when I say that the children's children are in foster care, some of them are not placed with the parent, meaning the teen parent, because they didn't have the skills to take care of them. And they're not capable of taking care of them. So they're separated. So now that teen parent is separated from their parent, and now they're separated from their baby. Could you imagine what that teen parent is going through? So this is why I say that's where you come in. you come in into a place where it might be the perfect time to come into this child's life. They also present the systemic barriers for the African American, Indigenous, and other children and youth of color, as well as LGBTQIA2S. That's our lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer or questioning, intersex, asexual, and two-spirit population. They face in receiving culturally appropriate mental health services and supports. So we, as an agency and as an individual, we support all the children. That's another population that is hard to place. Because when a foster parent says that it's a teenager that's about maybe 15 or 16 and they've been in the system for a little bit, sometimes they come in at 15 and 16 years old, so don't be surprised because that happens. They identify other than who they present to be. A lot of foster parents and families don't want them. They don't want them in their home because I guess they figure if they have a child in their home that they'll, what they consider, turn their child. Now, I'm not even going to get into all of that because I'm not trying to persuade anybody one way or the other to take or not to take because of a gender. So I'm going to leave that alone, but I am letting you know that that population needs as well as every other population. Now, we're going to take a break right now. And when we come back, we're going to discuss a little girl's journey from birth to foster care to adoption. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you so much for coming this far with me. Every time I hear that song, I definitely get choked up. That song, I believe, was made and recorded in 1985. And it was for something totally different than what I'm speaking about today. But to me, it fit. It fit foster care. It fit these children. It fits. And that's the only song that I just wanted to put with this. And I did see your message, Erica. And yes, I am so happy that you would love to be a foster parent. I'm going to get to that in this story. I do want to talk about the books that you've just seen. I've written a series of children's books on foster care and adoption, and it's the Stacey F. series of children's books. What is the protocol of someone who lives in your home is a felon? If the person is a felon, they probably won't allow you to be a foster parent, but they'll look into the case and to see how long ago it was and what the case was about, what happened, because certain cases, maybe it was something that wasn't severe. If it was like for murder or for rape or something like that, I can tell you absolutely not. But if it was for something different, they would have to find out from the organization, company, agency, what would deter them from being one. What level of felony was it? It does take a special person to love a child that's not biologically theirs. Well, the children that I have, again, they were my nieces and nephews. They weren't my biological children. Even though they're my nieces, it did not matter to me. That's just something that I do. I've been doing it since I was in high school, to tell you the truth, but that's another story. It just goes back that far of me taking on children and taking care of them. So I believe everybody is special. No, everybody cannot be a foster parent. Some people don't even want children, and I get it. I'm gonna be honest, I was like that when I had graduated from high school. It wasn't my intention to be a parent or a foster parent, anything else. I just wanted to go to college, but life happened and he happened and he tapped me and said, this is what I need for you to do. And I've been doing it ever since. So I'm very happy. If I had to do it all over again, I don't think I would do it differently. Maybe at different stages in my life, maybe, but I would probably still be a foster parent. I think that it would be. Thank you so much, Eric, for loving the commercial. So I want to talk to you about the journey of Stacey F. And we use the F because they have a right to their privacy, and we just say the initials so it won't identify who the person is. But as you see from the first book, it was she named me Stacey, and I titled that book because her mother gave her that name. And it was best for her to keep something from her mother. Her mother felt as though she couldn't care for Stacey at that time. So she figured it was best to place Stacey in the agency and with the organization. But the thing about this is that a lot of kids come into care for abuse and neglect. Now, abuse could be substance abuse. Neglect could be leaving a child alone and unattended. And it could be many different reasons. And a lot of our children come into care for neglect. Stacey's choice at that time was mom, knowing that she could not care for Stacey. So she was able to speak to the social worker. I'm not going to give you too much of that first book because I do want you to get it. And I do want you to start to follow the journey of a child in foster care. And I meant generic enough for anyone who has the book. I see I'm adopted and I didn't know what love was until I had my son. Oh my gosh. LaTanya is going to be one of our people that I'm going to be talking about later. Thank you so much for coming on, LaTanya. And it is great to know what love is. And I know that you have a happy and healthy son because I can see that smile, that beautiful smile on your face. So I know he's a happy and healthy young man. Stacy's journey through that phase, she came into care, but Stacy was an infant when she came into care. So she didn't know too much. The only thing that she may have known was that the care and love that she was getting was not from her biological mother, because kids have an instinct, baby has an instinct. She didn't have that bonding period in time, but she was able to bond with her foster parent. So we go into Stacy's mom, still wasn't able to do what she needed to do. So Stacy stayed in care a little longer. So she went into a temporary home, which is the second book in the series. A temporary home for Stacy. So Stacy had that temporary home. She stayed with that foster parent for a while. But see, that foster parent was a good foster parent to Stacy, but she did not want to adopt Stacy. And Stacy had reached that point to where her mother's rights was going to be terminated because she did not continue to work with the agency so she can get Stacy back so they can be reunified. So they had to look for another foster home for Stacy, which was one that was an adoptive home. And that's when we get to the third book, which is Stacy F., My Forever Mommy. And we say My Forever Mommy because that was where Stacy found her forever mommy and Stacy was adopted. But in those three books, it shows you the journey. It takes you through the court process, sets of it. It takes you through leaving one foster home and going into another foster home. And it gives you a little bit more insight into foster care. I didn't want to make it too confusing because this book was basically for children who came into foster care and a foster parent to get the book and be able to talk with the child and to engage the child. Because the child, again, may be frightened and scared. But if they see there's another child that's been through this, that foster parent can talk to them. And it's also good for social workers because a lot of times these kids don't want to talk to the social worker. You just took me from my parent. So I have nothing to say to you. So you can use this book as well. One of the books is a coloring and activity book, which is the last book, the colorful one with all the little hearts around it. You can use that book because it has a lot of activities in there. And while the child is doing the activities, foster parent can find out what the child likes and what the child dislikes. As the social worker, you may be able to get a lot of information from this child. Like say one part of the day, show Stacy going to an ice cream parlor or maybe going to get pizza. That child may say, oh, we go to whatever name of pizza parlor she go to, Zach's Pizza, and that's around the corner from my grandmother. So the social worker can then start to engage and find out more information about the grandmother. Well, what is grandma's name? She may tell them, do you know the street? Yeah, it's around the corner from Zach's Pizza. Can you take me there? That's how they can find out where the grandmother is, and maybe Stacy can be placed with the grandmother. So I tried to make these books easy for the child, for the foster parent, as well as for the social worker. Now, I know the social worker has it down pat, but that engagement piece, that engagement tool is very important. And that's why I did the series on Stacy F.'s books, because I felt as though it was easy. Some people ask, how do I become a foster parent? Well, there is an application process. And it involves maybe 5 or 6 scheduled visits to your home. It's called the home study. Over 10 to 12 week period, you may continue to have contact with the agency because their staff members are going to be gathering paperwork. Now, Erica, you had mentioned some information before. What if the person has a felony in the home? They do a background check, criminal history. They interview all family members in the home. When I say all family members, if you have an 8-year-old, they're going to talk to that 8-year-old. They're going to want to talk to that 8-year-old. I know some people may say, why talk to the 8-year-old? Because that 8-year-old may not want another child in that home. And it could be a problem placing another child in that home. So that's the reason why they interview everybody. You may have a husband in the home, or maybe the husband wants to be the foster parent and the wife is in the home. She doesn't want any more kids because she doesn't want to take care of any more kids. So they have to interview them. They want to know, are you okay with being a foster parent? Are you having this child in your home? Why do you want to be a foster parent? They're going to ask you a lot of questions, and they should, because they're placing somebody's child in your home. They will inspect your home for safety. They want to make sure you have enough space in your home for this other child. The child has to have their own room. And if you have, like, say, a little girl that's 7 or 8 years old, and they want to bring another 7 or 8-year-old little girl in your home, they can share a room, but they have to have their own bed. And the room has to be big enough for both children to move around in there. They have to have their own space. Most states will not allow you to have bunk beds. And I know that's a thing from some people say, oh, I can make space. We can do bunk beds. Well, I'm from old school. Those bunk beds are a mess. I don't know how many times the bunk bed fell on me and my niece and cousins and whatnot. And they were good sturdy ones. Maybe we were a little rough, but bunk beds fall. Bunk beds hurt. Bunk beds can kill. So they do not want you to use the bunk beds. I know people say, oh, you can screw them in. Oh, they have those heavy ones, those stainless steel ones. That's the bends. Screws pop out. Kids play with screws and they come out. I know you may say, well, I put my kids' bed together and it's here, but it's already on the floor. The worst that's going to happen is the mattress is going to go down and it's just going to hit the floor and they may slide a little bit. But a bunk bed, that's going to come down on the child that's underneath and they can crush them, plus break the neck of the child that's on the top. And you know there's a ladder, the kids like climbing up and down, and that's a safety hazard. So they do have to inspect your home. They'll give you explanation of your responsibilities of foster parenting, careful screening process. So it helps determine whether the family who wants to be fostering this child, whether you're the right fit for this kid. And if it's yes, it helps us match a child in your home. You may say, oh, I want a 10-year-old. Maybe you do want a teen, hint, hint. Maybe you want someone older, that like you more of a mentor. You want to help a young man stay on the straight road. Maybe you do want to parent a teenage girl who is having a baby, already had the baby. So that's what it may take to be a foster parent. But what I would suggest is you contact your local Department of Social Services, because every state's process is different. Most of them are the same. Everyone does a background check, no matter what state you're in. But there's just maybe a few little things that may be a little different. A lot of states that you have to do the fire test, you know, the fire department, somebody has to come out and check and make sure everything is safe. Yes, it is that serious. And you should be happy, because they're looking at your house to make sure you're safe too. And no, it doesn't cost you anything to have that inspection. So allow that to happen if that's the journey you want to take. You will need special training. In most states, you will be required to be licensed. And in other states, you'll need other types of training. Some people want to take children who have mental health. Some people want to take children who are severely disabled. And that's okay, but you have to have special training for that. In either case, your local Department of Social Services will provide everything you need, including the orientation. Once you finish with all the classes, you do have to go for orientation. Excuse me, I'm losing my voice. You have to go to ongoing trainings. You just don't do that one training and it's stir and mix and here you go with a kid. You have to have ongoing training, and it's so beneficial. And you're gonna learn so much. You sit in groups of other people, other foster parents, and you start learning a lot about foster kids and what works for them and what may work for you and different things like that. You're gonna have regular in-person visits. So you'll work with the foster parent, and the social worker will work out a time and schedule for them to come visit your home, because they have to come to visit your home. As long as that child is in your home, they have to continue to make visits. They're not going to drop the child off and they'll say, see you at court time. No, every month they make a visit. Sometimes in certain states, it's twice a month. You get 24-hour on-call support. It's not just a robotic thing. They do have after hours. They do have somebody that has to be available because it could be an emergency. And they have other tools to help you learn and develop your skills along the way. So it is important for you to go to all of these classes and to do these things to become a foster parent if that's what you want to do. Foster parents do receive compensation to cover the room and board and the cost of foster children. It varies in every state. I couldn't begin to tell you, oh, in this state they pay that state they pay this. A child with a disability gets maybe a little bit more than the child that doesn't. Your local department can explain the current rate and the structure and the payment system. But this money that is provided is to cover such expenses as food, clothing, shelter, and transportation. It's not to give you money every month to go to the Bahamas and leave the child with the neighbor. That's not what the money is for. So if anybody, and I hope nobody is listening, is in it for the money, then please turn it off right now. I'm gonna be cruel about it. I'd rather for you not to be on here right now. If you're considering being a foster parent, because that's a quick way of making money, because that's a quick way of pissing me off. And that's not something you wanna do. Please, if you really and seriously want to be a foster parent, don't say you wanna do it for the money. Say you wanna do it because you love doing and making sure that these children are safe. You use this money for transportation for the child to get back and forth, not to go out and buy yourself a new Mercedes. Use it for recreation. Now, I understand sometimes you may have to take a cab here and there. Your car may be down. And yeah, you can use the money for gas and things like that. But don't go out and buy a brand new shiny car for it. It's not for that. You can give these kids allowance, age appropriate allowance. And you should not consider this money income, because it is not income. You will not be responsible for your child, the foster child's medical, because they come with, in some states, Medicaid. So they're covered under dental and vision and pediatric appointments. And if they're over 18, they have adult appointments, but they're still covered. As far as their education, Their education is covered until they are 26 years old and they can go to college and get a college degree. So you see how important it is to have these young children, these teenagers in your home, because they can go to college and you're not paying it. They can still go to college. You can encourage them, because a lot of them may be thinking, my parents can't afford this. I'll never be able to go to college. And it's not to deter them to say, well, stay in care because you can go to college. So if you go home, you won't. That's not what we're saying. We're saying while they're in care, these are the supports that they receive. There is no minimum income requirement. However, you must have an income, a reliable income, one that shows that you pay taxes for it. That's a reliable income. Speak to your local department to see what classifies as a reliable income, because every state could be different. Your income must be earned and it should be sufficient to meet the financial needs of your family. So before you become a foster parent, they want to know about your bills. If your lights is turned off, if your water bill is high, they want to know about those things. Are you behind in your mortgage? Yeah, now this is one of those things where we heard back in the day, don't let a social worker in your house because they're going to get in your business. That was those Claudine days. Well, they will get into your business if you're going to take a foster child for the money. They're going to get into your business because they want to make sure that you're not behind in your mortgage and you need that money just to catch up in your mortgage. So that's what I mean when they say they're going to get into your business. They'll get into your business that way. I hope that I have been clear enough tonight to let everybody know about being a foster parent. Children in foster care range in age from infants to 21. In most states, you have to be 18 before you age out. But in a lot of states, they're keeping them until they're 21. The average age of a child in foster care is more than 8 years old, and there are slightly more boys than girls. There's also siblings who enter foster care, and they're separated from one sibling to the other. They're separated. Some of them don't even see each other. What I want you to do for me and for these children, it's to honor National Foster Care Month by becoming a foster parent. Now, just because May celebrates Foster Care Month, it doesn't mean that you wait till next May to do it. You can do it June, July, August, and keep going throughout. You can start the process tomorrow. Start finding out about your local Department of Social Services. You can make phone calls, and you'll probably get a voice prompt for that. But a lot of them have 1-800 numbers for you to contact. Now, on the back of that slide that you saw, you have my contact information. Now, I'm not in every state and I can't cover every state. If you do want to call me, I don't have a problem with talking to you about it to try to help you. If you may have some questions that you may need answered, I'll try to answer them the best that I can. But it's best for you to contact your local Department of Social Services because they can give you better information. I see LaTanya saying they need to get in their business because these children matter. Yes, you're right. You're right, LaTanya. They do need to get into their business. It is. It is horrible that this is what happens, but it is what it is. And some people, and that's what they want to do. They just want to take it for the money. But social services is smart enough to know who's in it for the money and who's in it for the long haul, because sometimes that's exactly what it is. It's a long haul for these children. And they need that support. They need that supportive person to be there with them. One of the hardest things for some foster parents that I've heard is when it's time for them to go home. It's hard on the foster parent, but it's a good feeling also because you know that the parent worked along with the Department of Social Services to get their child back because their child was worth it. And these children are so happy. Maybe you can stay connected with the child. I don't know. That would be up to the parent. There are some good stories with foster parents and biological parents. I know people have heard some nightmare stories, but stop listening to every story that you hear about foster care because everybody's story is not the same. Everybody deals with the department in different ways. Now, I know, I'm going to be honest, I was one of those people that believed what Ms. So-and-so said about social workers coming into your home and getting into your business. Well, see, now I'm a social worker. And I only get into your business when you're not doing the right business. So that's the only way that I get into your business. But just take care of the child, and that's all I ask for you to do, and that's all the departments are asking for you to do. But if you've been hearing this message, you listened to this entire episode, and for that, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Join me on Basic Black After Dark on May 19th as we continue to honor National Foster Care Month, where my guests will be a panel of former foster youth children, but they're now adults because they're over 21 and they aged out successfully. They're going to talk about their transition out of the foster care system. And one of the people who had made statements, she's going to be on, and that's Miss LaTanya. She'll be here to talk to us about her transition. Remember, Basic Black After Dark on May 19th, after 8, after dark. Thanks again for watching us.
Basic Black After Dark, the all-new podcast show with your host, Black Diamond.